Last time I was here, it was 11 years ago when the project finished.
When we did the end of project conference for the Gansu Basic Education Project.
Actually, intentionally, I tried to avoid coming back and because I want to see a clean case.
I haven't been back since, and I'm excited to be back.
Hello.
To want to see what happened in the project, schools, the teachers, the kids.
I'm very excited about that. I'm also quite apprehensive about that.
I'm really curious about what we can find out after 11 years of completion.
What I'm really looking for is where the concepts, the ideas, were the capacity that we built in individuals, are those still there? Beginning of the project, there was very, very little. We would go to schools where there were no books. There were no desks and chairs in some of the poorest teaching points.
15 years ago, the situation was so desperate, and anything we do could make a change.
Actually, we changed the education system through different interventions.
Such as equity.
The new inspection model.
New types of teacher training.
School development planning.
The participatory teaching.
Happy campus for kids.
And the scholarship program targeting the poorest children, especially the girls.
Supplementary readers.
Better hygiene for kids.
Everything worked together. It's just like a jigsaw. You put them together, tend to be a beautiful picture in the end.
The net enrollment rate for the whole four counties that we were working in went up from 79 to 91% within a period of just 6 years, which is phenomenal in my experience.
I think for some very specific reason, this project was very successful.
Eleven years on, Gansu has made dramatic changes. The government is pumping lots more money into rural education, and more students than ever are attending school. Everywhere schools are being rebuilt, bigger and better, and more modern, with the biggest change for the smallest people. Free kindergartens in every village.
I'm really impressed to see so many kindergartens built within the primary school, and the government provide free kindergarten for the kids. I heard that the enrollment is pretty high.
幼儿园修建我们就是688所学校它的困难，我们排队，排队就是最困难的排在最前面。这个方法我感觉到就是中央像我们当时给我们培训的时候，很一致的。
What we did find was that the counties had put into their plans that 5% of the non-salary budget should be spent on teacher training. That is real progress.
中英甘肃技术项目向我花费了很大的气力，花费了很大的人力和财力，在校长培训和教师培训中做了大量的工作，给我们留下了宝贵的财富。
The project trained over 6,000 teachers multiple times. Introducing participatory teaching into Gansu's poorest schools. 11 years later, everyone is still enthusiastic about the modern teaching style.
每节课就是老师讲的不能超过25分钟，那么更多的让学生去参与，通过学生的参与来生成这个东西。老师只是一个引导者，然后就是呢，通过
自己的一些讨论，然后产生问题，然后再解决问题。
现在就跟着通过那个理念以后，老师跟那个同学生之间的距离拉近了，就像我自己的孩子一样。
And of course, the kids love participatory teaching too.
老师让我们分角色朗读的原因是让我们更记得更清楚。
然后在英语课中有什么不会的，可以向组长讨论。
我们那一节课觉得很好玩，下课的时候我都记住了那些问题。
表演的这些我都很喜欢，所以能让我理解得更深，记得更深。
I think we have high expectation on the participatory teaching in the classroom.
Yet in most of the classes visited during this review, students were learning in a more traditional style.
我愿圆圆，
我愿圆圆，
爷爷的
恩，
爷爷爱的
恩，爷爷的恩，
爷爷爱的恩，
When we look at what we see in the classroom, I have to say I feel a bit disappointed. Not completely disappointed, I can see some good things as well. But especially something like participatory teaching.
能用的课我们就可以拉到一块儿，就是参与式教学做。如果不能用的，我们还是沿用以前的那种。
不太经常，有时候这样，稍微做一下游戏这样的。每个月就五六次。
In many other classes, the young students were kept busy with self-study. Rarely did teachers ask students to discuss problems among themselves. Somehow, this class discussed their ideas in total silence.
I think the government put a lot of resource on training, but they all go to this kind of large-scale lecturing.
现在的培训跟那个中医项目的培训有点接近，但是完全不一样。他那个现在就是培训期以后，就是通过讲座。
How do you keep participatory methods of teaching going? And that requires refresher training. It requires capacity building.And those things, I think, probably need a bit more attention than they're getting at the moment.
如果老师会再多这样组织我们做这样的游戏，我会更喜欢上课的。
We've seen school development planning, which is excellent.
When we visited Madame Dong's school the other day, she showed us a very good example.She updated SDP format a little bit by incorporating all teachers' work plan in the SDP. She encouraged all teachers to design each class with structured activities step by step.
比如说 SDP 的制定，我们家长的参与、孩子们的参与、老师的参与都非常的积极了。
那么项目结束以后，因为受了外面的专家的干预和支持，那么下面学校它就产生了一种惰性。因为说那句话，做起来的时候要及时去参与，要进行访谈呀、座谈呀，工作非常的复杂，所以校长他为了走捷径，把这一块就省掉了。所以这是说话这句话得不到推广的原因，我觉得主要还是在我们的决策层，在我们的教育行政部。
I think what I see with SDP is I see that they like the idea because they're used to planning anyway. They could see that it was more practical. But then when Bin and I were talking to one of the head teachers, he said, yeah, but we have so many requirements from the government. We can't fit it into an SDP.
Yeah.
It doesn't fit in that format. So we're kind of still doing it, but not the way that we did it when GBP was here.
SDP 现在没有做，但是这种理念仍然在学校里边可持续发展。
During the project, we introduced problem trees as a particular method of trying to analyze what the problems were. They've taken that concept and they've extended it themselves so that they now ask their own students to do that about their own learning problems and about other problems to do with the school. And so, where we might have done one or two diagrams, they've now got
100 or 200. So this is a good example of taking a concept that we helped to introduce and then extending it way beyond anything that we had actually intended at the time. So I'm very impressed by that.
Ideas like participatory teaching and school development planning have since spread across China.
当年中英项目的很多的先进的教育理念和教育方法已经融入到我们国家和我们省的教育发展的重大的战略决策中间。
就是我觉得它教育理念确实非常先进。你看十几年以前我们甘肃就在推这个才艺式教师培训，在推呢这个校长这个培训的这个学校发展计划。那么我们国家呢实际上2013年在这个义务教育学校专业标准里面呢才开始要求呢去做学校的发展规划。但是很多省呢都不知道这规划到底应该怎么样去做。
Free lunch was considered a project failure. Piloted in just 2 remote schools, it was hugely successful at getting kids into school, but was dropped due to financial and cultural considerations.
But now it became the national policy. We saw schools all provide either free breakfast or free lunch.
特别是家长啊，对学校的认可度也提高了。同时啊，家长也不再为中午学生吃不上午饭的问题担忧了。
As well as being totally in line with all the research that says children need nutrition and they need water and they need stimulation at the beginning of the day in order to be able to learn well in the classroom.
The success of the project was largely due to the way international consultants paired with national consultants worked with local counterparts, combining their knowledge and experience to help solve the problems local people had.
我们中国和联合国教科文组织有信托基金在非洲国家做8个国家的项目，我也是叫 consultant。但我总感觉在这里头，这个项目的设计过程当中，没有专家的参与，这个效果就会差很多。
因为我在很多地方想复制甘肃项目里面做的事情，总是缺1到2个关键要件，它就是做不成。
这个项目所做的全纳教育的做法，到今天为止，在中国还没有达到这样一个层面。
这个项目给你提供了一个空间，让你在这个里面去按你自己的方式理解，就是更好的教育应该是什么样子。
One of the regrets that I've had in reviewing the project is that we didn't train enough of the county officials early enough in the project.
So I think if we had a chance to do it again, we really think about to put more emphasis on education officials, put on the integration with the current system.
If we had more county education bureau staff trained systematically in GBEP ideology and practices, we may have a better picture for sustainability.
We should have trained all of those officials so that they were all understanding the project and all supportive of the project.
After the project finished, officials 200 miles away in Lanzhou District, Gansu, took on an expanded participatory teacher training, investing time and money to great effect.
扬州区当时搞参与式教学，有一个协和初中。之后呢，他这部分学生经过3年的参与式教学以后呢，学习，那么到高中，新的高中的教学方法完全是那种讲授式的。那么这些接受过参与式教学的这些学生，他们就受不了了。那么6位同学去专门去到校长那儿，给校长提建议，他说。高中的教学应该搞参与式教学。当时这个校长非常纳闷，这个校长呢就跑到协和初中去做了一个调查，这个校长感觉得非常好。完了以后呢，他也把他的这种协和的这种教学方法让他们的老师去采用去学习，这也是一个很好的一个例子。